There's no one in town, I know. You gave us some place to go. I never said thank you for that. Thought I might get one more chance. What would you think of me now? So lucky, so strong, so proud. I never said thank you for that. Now I never have a chance. May angels lead you in. Here you meet my friends on sleepless roads, the sleepless go. May angels lead you in. So what would you think of me now? So lucky, so strong, so proud. I never said thank you for that. Now I'll never have a chance. May angels lead you in. Here you if you were with me tonight, I'd sing to you just one more time. A song for a heart so big, God wouldn't let it live. May angels lead you in. Hear you.
Good morning and welcome. I especially want to welcome, we have many visitors with us here today. I'd like to introduce Mr. John Meharry from the Royal Canadian Legion, Branch 280, and he's going to lead this first part of the ceremony for us. Thank you, John. Welcome.
Well, we got a full house almost, something we like to see. I'd like to introduce myself. First of all, my name is John Meharry, and I'm a member of Branch 280. the Royal Canadian Legion. And I welcome each and every one of you here today. And it is a great pleasure, not only for myself, but also for our color party to be here to help you celebrate the 11th of November, which is Remembrance Day. If you're able, would everyone stand? Sergeant at Arms, please march on the color party. Now have the singing of O Canada. At this time, it is customary for us to call upon call the roll for the members of our branch and those that have passed on. Jack Phillips.
They do not answer, sir.
George M.
They do not answer, sir.
Ernie Livingstone.
They do not answer, sir.
Jim Kirby.
They do not answer.
Terry Leichhardt.
They do not answer, sir.
And our past president for BC Yukon Command, Bob Brady. Inasmuch as these, our comrades, do not answer, may their names live forevermore. Let us pray. O God, we remember before you those who laid down their lives for freedom and truth. We commend their souls into your gracious keeping and prayer, and pray that they will be ever worthy of their sacrifice. Help us to be faithful and true to those ideals for which they fought and died. May we continue to perpetuate the memory of our dearly departed comrades by our service in the country, community, and comrades. And remembering our solemn obligation, may we ever pray. Lord God of hosts, be with us yet. Lest we forget. Last post. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. The piper will play lament. Thank you. Ravelli. Just before we march off the colors, I'd like to take this opportunity to ask every one of you to pick out a veteran that's here this morning and go and speak to him, ask him where he served, ask him what the war was actually like in his eyes. I'm quite sure they'd be more than willing to give you any information you're seeking, and it would be an honor to them to have you come and speak to them. Thank you. Would everyone rise? Sergeant at Arms, march off the colors. Please be seated. Once again, I'd just like to say thank you very much to all of you for having us here today. It is a pleasure for us to come and help you celebrate the November the 11th Remembrance Day. And we enjoy coming here, and this is probably our fifth or sixth year that we've come with the color party. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, John. It's because we are free in this country that we are free to proclaim the good news of Jesus here without fear of reprisal. It's amazing. So let's never forget what a privilege it is for us to live in a free country where we can come and go as we please. We don't have to worry about the police coming in the middle of the night and taking our stuff or taking our people. We have the freedom to dissent, and we have the freedom to vote. And let's be not only good Christians, but let's be good Canadian citizens. Does that sound good to you?
Yep.
All right. Welcome to you all. It's always great for you who are regularly here for us to see you. And we don't want to take you for granted. We are delighted that you're here this morning, but we also have a number of visitors here today. You're new to us, and we are really glad that you've come. Maybe you have come because of our remembrance feature today, and maybe you've come because you're new to town, and we would love to be able to touch base with you. And we have connection cards that are found in the pew in front of you. And if you would fill that in, that would be great. And today, we have a newcomer's lunch right after church. And so if you would take that little card with you and you just follow your nose, my wife made some chili. Today is a chili feast. And it drove me crazy coming here with that chili in the car. So after service, all of you who are new in the last little bit, and you would like to join us for lunch, we'd love to have you. There will be some of the leadership there, and we can have a great chat together, and I'm going to run for my wife's chili. So that's going to be over here. Five Corners Christmas. Tickets are going for Five Corners Christmas. You're aware of that, the first week of December. As of the end of the week, we have given away about 2,000 tickets already. So if you want to be part of that, why don't you make sure and you get those tickets soon. I think that's all that I'm going to mention for what's happening around here. But it would be great for you to stand at this time and greet each other. Would you do that?
Some water.
pray with me now. This is a written prayer, and it's by Thomas A. Kempis, a 14th century priest. But pray with me now as I read it. Write thy blessed name, O Lord, upon my heart, there to remain so indelibly engraven that no prosperity, no adversity shall ever move me from thy love. Be thou to me a strong tower of defense, a comforter in tribulation, a deliverer in distress, a very present help in trouble, and a guide to heaven through the many temptations and dangers of this life. Amen.
Night.
Amen? Praise God. Praise God. Amen.
People who love Jesus in free nations declare this to be true. But also Christians who live in repressed nations declare this to be true. For this, friends, is our freedom. Let's not forget it. Let's live as free people. Please be seated. All right. Let me invite the ushers to join me at the front, if you would. I just want to mention, at the end of our time, we have the latest Alliance magazine is ready for us. And some of you got it this morning and some of you didn't. The ushers will make it available to you as you leave today. If you don't know anything about the Christian and Missionary Alliance, you want to know kind of what our heartbeat is about, this is the latest edition of that, and in it is a very interesting article about military chaplaincy. We have a lot of Alliance chaplains in first responders, in hospitals, in seniors' homes, and in the military. You can read about that, as well as how A powerful outreach tool of the early Alliance was radio ministry. And this church used to have a regular radio show. How many of you were ever on that radio show? Anybody? Yeah. Good. So you can read about that in that magazine. I think that's all that I'm going to mention with regard to that. Thank you for your conscientious giving. We appreciate it. And I think today, once I have finished dedicating the offering to the Lord, then the children can go to their children's church time. I think it would be just good for us as being good neighbors, for us to remember the election on Tuesday south of the border. It's one of the greatest democracies in the world, and you've been following it, and I just think we need to pray that God would have his way in our neighbors to the south. So why don't you pause with me as we dedicate this offering and pray for this as well. Heavenly Father, we, at this season of the year, around Remembrance Day, many of us who have grown up in a time of freedom can very easily take it for granted and think this is the way it has always been and always will be. Some among us who are older have both been in a war and also have been civilians who have fled a war. And they know that this is not necessarily true. Sometimes it can change. And so today, Lord, as we come toward Remembrance Day, we want to thank you for this great gift of being able to live in a country that is free. And now, Lord, we do think about our neighbors to the south, and you know the struggle that they have as they look at two candidates that many people want neither. And they don't know what to do. And Lord, somehow, you who are the God of angel armies, we pray that whatever happens on Tuesday, that somehow you would receive glory and that you would be seen as the King of the United States of America. So our prayer is that somehow through this time that you would be with the candidate who was elected, and that they would bow their knee to you, that they would recognize that they are simply a steward of the seat in which you have placed them. And we ask, Lord, that that country may remain free, for the gospel has done great work in the U.S. and has gone all over the world as a result of Christians from that place. So we commit this next couple of days to you and pray for wisdom and for your glory. And now, Lord, we give to you as an act of worship. With thanksgiving, would you receive it as such? In Jesus' name, amen.
This year, we are taking a slightly different approach to Five Corners Christmas, our seventh annual outreach event to the Chilliwack community.
The play is called Found and is set in modern-day Chilliwack, featuring a dairy farming family. How very Chilliwack is that? It's a thought-provoking story with a strong biblical message of hope and love.
From year to year, we'll be presenting fresh new stories with a gospel message clearly presented. We may still visit other time periods in other years, but that'll depend on the story we are trying to tell.
We have a brand new set this year as well that we think you'll really love. But the event that you have come to know and love is essentially the same. There'll be lobby displays, a full-length play, food and music at the intermission, and a kids feature called The Brooks Barn.
This is a wonderful Christmas event you won't want to miss. Please consider attending and think through who you may invite to come with you as well.
Good. Truly, you know, it's showing the snow coming down, but after the last couple of weeks, is that really where it's at? It's more like, wow, wow. We had the One Life, One Chance annual celebration in the gym last night, and the drains are on the inside of the wall, like it comes down the roof and into the inside of the wall. Man, it felt like I was in a swimming pool last night. It was unbelievable, but anyway, it was a great time. Well, good morning to Video Cafe. I don't think it's raining that like that today, so you'll be able to hear what's going on here, and mostly what you'll hear liquid-wise is the sound of people spilling coffee, but good to have you with us today. I think it's good for us to cultivate thankfulness, don't you? It's good for us to be thankful. We tend not to be thankful people. We tend to be people who have continuing high expectations, and when they're not met, we're unhappy with that, and it's good for us to be thankful. I think I'm going to move this out of... I think I'm going to move this out of the way. There. So today, I like each year when we have this remembrance time, I like us to consider... a soldier of the Bible, and you know, we're thinking about the military today, and we have this big howitzer out in the parking lot this morning. Did you notice that? Yeah. Well, somebody came in and said, you know, I just parked in the parking lot, and somebody took up two spots, and one of our ushers said, yes, and that gun is trained on that car. You know, Trump got ushered out yesterday in a rally. You know, and so security came and hustled him away. And I thought, Trump, you think you got security? How about us out here this morning? Like, that's cool. So we're thinking about the military today. And you know, the Bible is filled with military. Lots of military in the Bible. So much of the Old Testament involves the kings and the military campaigns and how God's people fit into the empires of the world as they poured up and down through the country of Israel. Lots of military in the Bible. And it's interesting to read about the earthly experience of the Son of God as he interacted with all kinds of people in his earthly ministry. He interacted with big sinners and with women, which was amazing for a Jewish rabbi. He interacted, of course, with the religious elite. He interacted with the diseased and the demonized who came to him and were healed. He interacted with children, and he interacted with the military. Jesus had a fair amount to do with the military. And Jesus lived in a time where the Roman Empire was at its peak. The Roman Empire began their intervention into the life of Israel in 63 BC. And they ruled the country through a selected indigenous king. They started with Antipater, who was part Idumean, and he ruled for a while, and then his son succeeded him, and his name was Herod the Great. And then he ruled until about 4 BC, and he was basically a part Jew and part Idumean, which always kind of grated on him and his people. But he was in the pocket of Rome, and he ruled Israel until that time. Then in 6 AD, Israel came under direct occupation and administration of the Romans. Until 70 AD, so from 6 to 70 AD, the Romans actually were present and ruling themselves over Israel until 70 AD, at which time the Romans grew sick and tired of the Jewish people and decided to eradicate them and destroy Jerusalem at that time and killed as many Jewish people as they could. So the Israel of Jesus' day was dominated by Rome and its military. Now, soldiers have a hard job to do. They're no-nonsense people. They're factual people. It was funny, the person who mustered this group this morning, I said to him as we were getting ready for the service, well, okay, go see if you can round up your people. You know, that's what we try to do here, you know, vainly. And he said, no problem. And they were all, woohoo. I just thought, how do you do that? It's because they're soldiers, right? They're no nonsense. They are brave and brutal. And they were part of an occupying force in Israel. Now, certainly, we read about the abuse that Jesus suffered at the hands of soldiers at the time of his crucifixion. It's terrible, terrible. But Jesus also had some very positive interactions with the military. And this morning in our time, I would like to look at three soldier interactions with Jesus and see what we can learn about how they saw him when they came into contact with him. I think we will be able to see ourselves in these three military interactions. And at the end of our time today, I'm going to invite you for spiritual response, so you can keep that in the back of your mind as we go through our time. So let's look at three soldier interactions with Jesus. And the first interaction that I want to have you think about is when they believe the lie. So would you go to Matthew chapter 28? It's the last chapter of the book of Matthew. In the main house, if you're using the Pew Bible, it's page 743. Video Cafe, it's page 999. And today we're kind of bopping around to various texts, but normally when we have a text, you can also find that on our app, and you can follow along that way as well. So Matthew chapter 28, let's look at this first military interaction today. It's at the end of Jesus' life, and we'll read the first 15 verses of this passage. Let me remind you that after Jesus died, they set a guard at his tomb lest there be a kind of a political incident. And so with that in mind, we come to chapter 28 after the resurrection. After the Sabbath, at the dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. And there was a violent earthquake. For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven. So they're tied together. There's an earthquake because the angel came. And going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. Yeah! His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. And the guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. And the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he's risen from the dead, and he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. Like, hello, he said. Wow. Talk about an understatement. And they came to him and clasped his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." So there's a picture of joy, overwhelming joy and reunion. But what happened to those guards? While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. And when the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Two very different experiences at the tomb. An earthquake, an angel, the stone rolled away. Just the appearance of the angel as these guards were in front, and these may have been temple guards, we're not quite sure, or they may have been Roman guards, we don't know for sure. But these guards who were trained to be resolute in all kinds of situations, this was out of their experiential grid. They had never actually encountered an angel in power before, and they just conked out from fear. They just fell right down to the ground. Lucky they didn't fall on their sword. They just laid there for a while. Imagine if you're a soldier and that's what happened to you. What happened to you? Oh, I passed out from fear. That's not a good thing. We read that the women ran to tell the news of the resurrection while the soldiers ran to tell the same news, just to different people. They both ran to tell the news. And a counter message from the soldiers' overseers was concocted. Now, I don't know a lot about soldiering, but I know that if you fall asleep at your watch, that you're going to go through a court-martial. It's not a pretty thing for you to sleep during your watch. And this was an important watch. It was allowed by Pilate. This was an important watch. So imagine these soldiers as they run and tell what has happened. They put great emphasis on angel, power, lightning, earthquake. This was a big deal. And they were thrown a lifeline. Like they expected to, you know, kind of kneel down and take the sword, but they were thrown a lifeline. And that is, they're to memorize and circulate a lie about what happened. Now, these soldiers weren't stupid. They realized this lifeline, and they were prepared to sacrifice conscience for the out that was given to them. Now, you know, if you put it to the test, you have to ask, with regard to the lie, if you're sleeping, how would you know what happened there? You know, the disciples came while we were sleeping. Well, how do you know that? But anyway, it doesn't go to a court of law, so we'll just leave that kind of hang. So in the first instance, the interaction with Jesus, these soldiers just took the money and ran. And you know, I think this is true of many people today. They have experienced times of God breaking into their life. They may have had a time or many times when they have sensed, you know what, God is doing something here. This is kind of a supernatural thing. And they may have even experienced Jesus in some relevant way. There's many people who come close to Jesus, for example, when they're young. And maybe they sang his songs with their hands in the air. Maybe they prayed to God. Maybe they even followed Jesus for a while. But time goes by, and the implications of continuing to follow him become too great. One thing that often happens with people who have encountered Jesus in some way is that they fall in love with somebody who does not love Jesus. And they think, oh, but he's such a hunk. And so it's like, do I continue with Jesus, or do I kind of put that aside? Many people who have encountered Jesus to some degree in the past, as time goes by, they have business opportunities that come along. And there's no time for Jesus anymore. They're busy with other things. And so denial of that whole thing or lies are tolerated in order to continue life the way it is now. And many, many people who know better about God and his son, or even just experiencing God in general, accept the bribes that the world has to offer. Money, position, power, sex, name your poison. And the bribes that are offered by the world are accepted by people instead of interacting in a continuing way with Jesus. We may even come to believe the story that Jesus is not risen, and that this world is all there is. Some people in Canada are like this first military encounter today with Jesus. But let me take you to the second encounter with Jesus. And I've put this under the thought, wait. Just go over the page to your left to Matthew chapter 27. And let's look at verse 50 to 54. And there are, you understand, there are companion accounts of these situations in the other Gospels, but I've chosen these ones to focus on today. Matthew 27, verse 50 to 54. So Jesus is on the cross and come to the time that he is going to expire. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. It was the time of his death. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Like, that was not this kind of a curtain. That's a big, it was a big, big deal. The earth shook and the rocks split. Think about this. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. Like, does that seem wacky to you? Like, this is a unique time. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. And when the centurion, Roman, and those who were with him who were guarding Jesus at the foot of the cross saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified. And they exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." What a terrible time the military had with Jesus at his crucifixion. They beat him terribly. Remember, they jammed a crown of thorns on his head and put a purple robe upon him, and they mocked him as the blood-spattered king of the Jews. When they got to the hill of Golgotha, they pounded nails through his hands and feet. And then, as he suffered on the cross, they gambled for his clothing. These are tough, tough people. They have seen it all. And they had watched through this experience how Jesus had conducted himself. For they crucified people all the time. And this is not how people conducted themselves during their hours of agony. Then Jesus cried out and died, and all heaven broke loose, and the centurion realized who Jesus was. Maybe this centurion, maybe his ilk were transformed by Jesus that day. Maybe they were. I don't know. But if they were, it was in the last moments of Jesus' mortal life. Are you a person who puts things off? Do you put things off? Are you a procrastinator? I remember when I went to Bible college. It's amazing how long a semester seems at the beginning of the semester. Until you come to the last week and the papers have not been done. You know what? I've lived for a long time now, but I still dream about that. You know, like, I remember one of our profs said, "You can put your paper in my mailbox at midnight, but at midnight, 12:01, I lock my mailbox and you can't put it in there." And you know, I ran there at 5 to 12, and I had to wait in line to put it in. It's a terrible way to live, you know. Have you heard of the term all-nighter? I remember, this is just for free, I remember my brother, who is not here today, and he roomed with my best friend next door to me at Bible school. I remember going in their room at about 2 o'clock in the morning, the night before a huge paper was due. And there they sat on their typewriters, in their underwear, eating cold McDonald's hamburgers and root beer. I thought, and these are the future church leaders. So the paper USA Today asked and received the top 5 things that we procrastinate about. Here they are. See if any of them are true of you. House chores and yard work. We just put that off. or holiday gift shopping?
I think that was mostly men, is that right? Men, Christmas Eve, what do you mean you're closing early?
Making doctor or dentist appointments.
Ooh.
Calling relatives.
Put that off. Or changing oil in the car. You know, that one is true of my car right now.
You got that little sticker up there and you go, oh, I think I can push it another, you know. We tend often to procrastinate. And with us, unlike the centurion at the foot of the cross, it isn't about Jesus dying that cuts our interaction short with him, but it is our dying that cuts our interaction short with Jesus. And so many people are guilty of procrastination regarding their soul. Many people say, I'll get religious when I get older. What they really are saying is, when I've had all my fun and I'm all used up, then God can have what's left over. And that's fine. That's fine. God will take you, broken and useless, as quickly as he will take you when you're in your prime. That's fine. But nobody knows what's going to happen. And nobody knows how much time is left. You know, for many people, death comes slowly. And I have seen this over my pastoral life. But I also know that many people who are dying really don't know that they're dying. I mean, everybody else can see it. They're just a wizened up slip of nothing left in the bed, and they're talking about what they're going to do like next summer. Everybody coming to see them says, you're not going to be here next summer. So a lot of people will die slowly, and sometimes they will know they're dying, and sometimes they won't know they're dying. But sometimes death comes swiftly for others. And you have no time. You have no time. So this is a big gamble to say, I'll take care of my destiny when I'm feeble and old. There's an old folk story told of Satan sitting around with his henchmen discussing how to ruin human beings. And one said, hey, I can tell them that there's no God. Or another one said, I can tell them that they can do whatever evil they want and there's no consequence to it. Or a third one said, no, I can tell humans that they have fallen too far and can never come back to God. And Satan said, no, I don't think so. I think I'm simply going to make them believe that there's plenty of time. I think a lot of people are like the second group of soldiers, and they maybe meet Jesus at the end, or they may wait until it's too late. So let's move to the third soldier interaction. So the first soldier interaction was to believe the lie and perpetuate the lie. The second soldier interaction was to wait until the time of death, either Jesus' death or their death. And the third one that I'd like to put before you is living under authority. And for that, we're going to go to the book of Luke chapter 7. Would you go over to your right? Luke chapter 7, page 768 in the house, 1034 in the cafe. Luke 7, very interesting interaction with military. Found it there? I can't hear pages turning in the cafe. When Jesus had finished saying all this in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. Capernaum was where he moved for adult ministry to Capernaum from Nazareth. And there a centurion servant, whom his master valued highly, was sick and about to die. The centurion heard of Jesus and sent some elders of the Jews to him, asking him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him, this man deserves to have you do this because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue. Amazing. So Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, Lord,
Don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed, for I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. And that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. And when Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd following him, he said, I tell you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel. Then the men who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well. Centurions were the backbone of the Roman army. They were in charge, usually, of a century of soldiers. A century is 100 soldiers. That's why they're called a centurion. They had control of 100 active men. The ancient writer, Jewish writer Josephus, describes the job description or the character description of a centurion. And this is what he wrote. Josephus wrote in around the 70 AD time when Israel fell. They are not a seeker of danger, so they're not, you know, foolhardy with danger, but they know how to command men. They are steady and reliable in action. They are not over anxious to run into a fight, but when they are hard pressed, they will hold their ground and be prepared to die there. That's a centurion. That's what this guy was. So this centurion was all of that. And you read it in what he, the message that he gave to Jesus. But he was also a seeker after God. We don't know what his nationality was, but he was under the Roman system, and he was dissatisfied with the Roman religious system, a panoply of gods and goddesses, and the emperor also, who was divine. And he grew dissatisfied with it. He said, I look at all that stuff, and I don't believe any of it. I just think it's a bunch of junk. So he's stationed in Israel. Maybe God put him there. And he started to interact with Jewish people. And he began to reject the popular culture he was raised in. And he began to identify with the Jewish people around him in their love of one God. And it's interesting because the Roman occupation over the Jewish people was a terrible relationship. It was a poisonous relationship. It was because of the repeated uprisings from the Jews that finally Vespasian and his son Titus came into Israel and said, let's clean everybody out of here. Let's clean their clocks. They besieged Jerusalem. They hung Jewish people on the crosses outside of the walls of Jerusalem every day. It was just filled with agony and horror. It's because the Jewish people would not say no to their God. They would not worship the emperor. They would not kowtow to the Romans. And so this situation was bubbling in the time of Jesus. In this poisoned relationship between Jews and Romans, this centurion sought Jehovah God. And he actually built their synagogue. He was not allowed to go in the synagogue. He's a Gentile. But he identified as much as he could and still be a centurion with the God of the Jews, Jehovah. It's interesting that when he heard about Jesus and the authority of Jesus, he sent Jewish friends to go to this Jewish rabbi. Well, if you were a Jewish person, you wouldn't do anything for a centurion. Zero. And remember, Jesus said, if somebody asks you to go 1 mile, you go 2 miles. That was often a Roman who would do that. Jesus' teaching was radical. So he sent Jewish friends. It tells you something about his thirst for God, because Jews can't go in his house, and he can't go in Jews' house, and he can't go to the synagogue, but he has people who say to Jesus, you need to do this for this guy, because of how warm he is to the God of Israel. This centurion knew about obeying and being obeyed. He understood authority, and he understood and recognized the authority of Jesus, this penniless Jewish rabbi. He sensed that authority. And so this centurion, who is used to commanding, humbled himself and placed himself in obedience to Jesus. He didn't even go himself. He didn't feel worthy to do that. He knew simply that Jesus, who had authority, only had to say the word. And his servant, or some scholars feel it was his son, would be healed. Jesus' word was the most powerful thing, and he submitted to the word of Jesus. And Jesus said to the crowd following him, I tell you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel. Jesus saw the centurion as a foretaste of millions, yes, billions of Gentiles who would come into relationship with God through Jesus. It's a foretaste. And who would know eternal salvation by trusting in Jesus. Wow. Quite a guy. Quite a guy. So we've looked at three soldier interactions today. Some believe the lie and deny. Some wait until it's close or too late. And other people recognize the authority of Jesus and place themselves under his authority and his word. So, which soldier do you identify with this morning? Which one are you? Are you one of the deniers who took the money and ran, simply ignoring the truth about who Jesus Christ is? Or are you the procrastinator, holding on to the slimming hopes that you will at some point come to grips with your destiny? Or are you like the centurion who recognized in Jesus the living word of God to be submitted to and obeyed? Jesus said in Revelation 3, verse 20, he said, behold, I stand at the door of your heart and I knock. And if anyone will hear my voice and open that door, I will come into them. And I will eat with them and they with me. A meal is a way of bonding together. Jesus said, I will bond with you and you will bond with me. Today, I want to give you an opportunity. Perhaps you've been in the first soldier's camp. Maybe you've been in the second soldier's camp and you are no longer happy to be there. Maybe today you would be like the third centurion and say, I want to place myself under the authority of Christ and the power of his word. And I want to give you an opportunity to do that today. We receive the authority of Jesus in our life through prayer. It's not through deeds, it's through an attitude of our heart, in which we just do business with our God, with God, just him and us. And we, as Jesus said, we open the door of our life to him and we let him come in and we have communion with him. We bond with him and he with us. And so I have written a prayer, and the prayer is not what's divine about this, but I believe if this expresses the attitude of your heart, that as you pray this prayer, just you to God, not to anybody else around you, I believe it has effect. So if we could have that up, Yeah. So we're going to be in an attitude of prayer now, and just do business with God, not anybody around you, but just you and God. And if this expresses the desire of your heart, then I would invite you to pray it silently along with me. But don't pray it to me, pray it to Him. So together, let's be in an attitude of prayer. God, I agree with Pastor Leon today. As I think about your son, Jesus, I believe he is the one who died to forgive my sins and to save my soul. I am sorry for my sins, but I'm thrilled that you would love me that much. I will not procrastinate on this issue. I receive you as my Lord and Savior today. Send your Spirit into my life to help me live as you would have me live. Thank you. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with all your heart, not to anybody else, but to God, Jesus said, I'm standing at the door of your heart. And if you'll open up the door, I will come into you. And we will begin to bond together. It's the beginning of a journey. And we would love to help you in that. And let me invite the band to come up. We're going to sing a great song to close our time. Isn't it amazing that a rough, tough soldier could teach us the right approach to spiritual vitality? But if you prayed that prayer today, I want to encourage you to tell somebody who you know would love to hear it. And if you don't have anybody to tell, we have friends who are at the front of the video cafe and the main house who are here to pray with you. And you know what? They would love to hear the prayer that you have prayed today. And we would love to be part of your spiritual journey as you walk with Christ. You may have come with somebody who has walked with Jesus for a long time, and they're a Christian soldier. Yeah, they know what it is. And I would encourage you to talk to them. So we're going to sing another kind of a military song, hey? The name of the Lord is a strong tower. And soldiers, to your feet. Let's give it a go.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Every once in a while in church, you get your favorite song, and I got mine today. Now, we got to work on the 100-voice black choir and about 15 extra decibels, but that's where it's at. All right. Well, it's been great to have you in service today, and I hope that your heart has been challenged, and if you took that step, I hope that you won't leave here without telling somebody, and we will try to help you on your spiritual journey. Five Corners Christmas tickets, you get those today. There is a museum, a war museum display is in the foyer. You go look at that, and if you're really brave, you go look in the barrel of that howitzer, all right? Also, don't forget that Connection magazine with an article on Christian chaplaincy in the military. It'll be a real encouragement to you, and I hope that you won't leave them here, but that you'll take it home and read it. Let me bless you in prayer before we go today. O Lord of hosts, we bless you today that you have given us peace in our heart. We are thankful for peace in our country, but help us never to forget that we are in the army of God, and we are placed here for a reason. We are not to sit idly, we're not to sleep at our watch, but we are to be about the Master's business. Thank you for each person here today. They are special to you. You are calling them. I pray that as they come to you, that they would see your hand at work in their life. Be with each one who prayed that prayer today. Holy Spirit of God, do something in their life this week that gives them the awareness that what has happened has been cosmic. So bless us each one. Bless your people, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. See you at the welcome lunch. Smell that? It's good, good.